Good morning, good morning. In conversation with LY. Good morning, family. Good morning. In conversation with LY here, ready to go. And we've got a strong program as usual for you this morning. Have pen and pencil ready so that you can write down appropriate information that you might want to retain. And we've got coming on board with us this morning. We'll have a conversation with Coach Butch McAdams. And then we're going to, of course, be looking forward to our legislative update from the fantastic state senator, the one and strong state senator from the 45th District, Senator Cory McCray. And we'll also expect to get some information on the Marilyn Mosby case. We suspect either Lou Fields or Bill Gooden will be giving us a call and letting us know, Smitty, what's going on this coming Friday morning so that you might be ready to accompany many who want to be part of the case that will be decided, or the judge will make his sentencing known to the public and her this coming Friday. So we'll have some information about that, and if you want to make your way to go, how you can do just that. Okay, well, let's see here. Do we have everybody on board? Come on board. I tell you, it takes a minute for it to warm up, but we're okay. Well, let's see here. We got, I was looking at this one of the best pictures I've seen. We didn't see it, of the Saturday, February 10th sports section. One of the better pitchers of Lamar. The quarterback earns the NFL's top honor for the second time in 6 years. Lamar Jackson, he received 49 out of the 50 first place votes. What happened to number 50?
I don't want to look. Biggie. Must have been a Patty Mahomes fan or something, but yeah, we got that one. But yeah, that game. How about that game, too? I'm definitely happy for Lamar, and look, I would have definitely loved that we topped it off going, because I think we would have played the better game than, you know, than the Chiefs did. Even though they won, I think we would have really beat the 49ers. But, yeah, Lamar, unanimous MVP, you know.
That was it. Not unanimous. That's what I'm
saying. Oh, the one away. You know, that's unanimous for me. One away is, you might as well, that's somebody that probably just had a personal vendetta, because you obviously can clearly see that everybody else got the picture, you know what I mean? But that one person was looking through some tilted shades. You know, the glasses was a little bit tilted.
Wow. Yeah. Well, I tell you what, he certainly looks here like he's dressed pretty decent.
Yeah. Lamar, so look, he cleaned up real nice.
We give him credit for that.
Mm-hmm.
A couple of things have happened since we last spoke, family. The U.S. Senate last night, passed a $95 billion aid bill, and to me, I've always felt that we put too much money into that defense. But the more I've been listening and the more I've been weighing how things are looking in this country, I think what the Senate did on Sunday, pushed this $95 billion emergency bill for Ukraine and Israel past a critical hurdle with a bipartisan vote that kept the legislation on track for passage within days. The vote was 67 to 27 to move forward on the package, which would dedicate $60.1 billion in helping Ukraine in its war against Russia aggression, send $14.1 billion to Israel for its war against Hamas, and funds almost $10 billion in humanitarian assistance for civilians in conflict zones, while addressing threats to the Indo-Pacific region. Now, in a rare Sunday session, 18 Republicans joined the Democrats to advance the measure, which leaders hope to the Senate will approve tomorrow or no later than Wednesday. It's no exaggeration to say that the eyes of the world are on the United States Senate. Now, this is interesting. And Donald Trump is, in a speech, basically blasting NATO. America is America, true. But we're not the only nation in the world. We need somebody to our right, our left, our north, and our south, our east, our west, to make sure that we are going to be watched and supported, too. This man sits back and says that if NATO countries fall short of their budget obligations, he would have no problem with Russia coming in and taking them over. Said it. Sick. The man is sick. Who think a United States president would tackle the NATO forces, our allies, our friends, our supporters? And he's bold enough to say, you don't pay your part of the bill? Okay. Then when Russia decides, or if Russia decides it wants to come in and do what it does, I'm not going to say nothing. And that's the president of the United States talking to our friends. The only thing that is worse, not the only thing that's worse, but one of the many things, is that I was looking at something the other day, I'm trying to find it right here, where Trump, seized black voters as an opportunity for the GOP. Now, Donald Trump isn't known for fostering deep ties to the black community. From his earliest days as a New York real estate developer, Trump has faced accusations of racist business practices. He spent years spreading the lie that Barack Obama, America's first black president, was ineligible to hold office. When he was president, Trump derided countries in Africa and said four congresswomen of color should go back to the broken and crime-infested countries they came from, ignoring that all of the women are United States citizens and three were born in the United States. But as he seeks the presidency for the third time, Trump is aiming to win over an unlikely constituency, black voters. Have you seen our poll numbers with African Americans and with Hispanic Americans? But I'm not that surprised because I see it, I feel it, Trump declared during a rally in New Hampshire days before this primary. We did great in 2016. We did much better in 2020. But there is much more enthusiasm now. There's a little evidence that Trump is making significant inroads with the black voters, who polls show remain overwhelmingly supportive of President Biden. But even minor changes in the voting patterns in critical states could shift the race in unexpected ways. For Biden, the biggest risk isn't a dramatic move among the black voters towards Trump. It's such voters frustrated by a range of issues, including the lack of progression emerging from the 2020 racial justice movement. Doesn't show up at all in some of the most narrowly divided states that could decide the next general election, including Georgia, Pennsylvania, and Michigan. Even minor shifts in voter turnout could sway the results. Nationally, only 50% of black adults in a Democratic American Express poll said they approve of Biden, down from 86% in 2021 of July. That shift represents a larger drop than among adults overall, and white adults in particular. At the same time, however, only 25% of black adults said they have a favorable view of Trump. Now, Trump campaign advisors insist they're aiming to jump on such shifts to spur a political realignment that would upend the Democratic Party's decades-long advantage with black voters. We are creating a massive problem for the Democratic Party's base that could be alternating for a generation, said Chris Latuva, a senior advisor in the Trump Organization. That's just an opportunity that we would be remiss if we didn't explore it. Cornell Belcher, a Democratic pollster, noted that Obama faced similar challenges with young voters and voters of color during his 2012 election, re-election. But many of the Democrats' bases were frustrated by his perceived slow pace of progress on key issues. I'm not surprised that Joe Biden right now starts off underperforming among young voters and voters of color. I'd be surprised if he didn't. But that's not the campaign is not over yet, Belcher said. Trump is hardly moderating his rhetoric on race. He quickly becomes the GOP's dominant presidential frontrunner. Just this month, he mocked Republican rival Nick Haley's birthday name, given to American-born daughter of her immigrant's parents from India. The episode had strong overtones in his early efforts to rely on race troops to question Obama's citizenship and eligibility to serve as a president. And he often highlights endorsements from black celebrities, including Keon West and Lil Wayne, as evidence of his appeal to the black community. He recently touted for endorsement of a black Rhode Island racial justice advocate and an endorsement from Black Lives Matter, a move that Black Lives Matter grassroots organization denounced. As he prepares for a rematch with Biden, Trump is stepping up his efforts to present a more diverse group of supporters than a group of supporters during his years in the White House, when he presided over a nearly all-white cabinet. When Trump won the New Hampshire primary last week, Tim Scott, the chamber's only black Republican, stood prominently behind him. Trump's vice presidential pick could be a key opportunity to expand its appeal beyond the party's overwhelmingly white base. Scott is among those who are frequently mentioned as a potential running mate for Trump. I'd be darned if that's not true. Jimmy Harrison, the chairman of the Democratic National Committee, accused Republicans of promoting fairy tales about their plan to win over the black voters. The reality is this. Their leader, Donald Trump, pals around with white supremacists, is fighting to overturn Obamacare, throw millions of black families off of their insurance. 10 to 13% of black men in a series that has been on NBC have stated that they are looking favorably on Trump. That is sickening. Sickening. And that is just absolutely sickening. Okay, I might find time to pick up more on this, but fam, I'm telling you, I'm going to do everything I possibly can do to labor long and hard to push down on how we must vote. We must register. We must register. We must be on the phones talking to lottie-dotting everybody. This is, I know you hear it often, this is the most important election that we have in front of us. It's the election right now. The election right now. We must beat Donald Trump. We must beat him. And black voters, we cannot be caught playing games and thinking that this man is going to be our friend. He's done nothing to show to us he intends to be our friend. All right, I'm going to pause because we got to pick up the rest. Yes, and Mark? All right, give me Mark.
Hey, good morning. Can y'all hear me?
I can hear you now, good man. And Big E already told us that a 59 to 50, 50, 49 out of 50 votes is okay, but I'm upset about it. But that's just me. Oh well, listen, you know what happened yesterday, don't you?
Yeah.
Super Bowl.
Yeah, Super Bowl.
And I sat there, and me and Will and Dana and Joe and Dale, we were trying to figure out how we're gonna play this thing. I've always said that my teams are Baltimore, Philadelphia, and Kansas City. But I must admit, for a little bit there, I felt a little strange and wanted to see San Francisco irk it in there. But anyway, they didn't do it. I'm going to sit down and let a man who knows it, live it, can give it to us real strong, and we're very fortunate. The clock allows him to come on board with us. Let's go to the sports line with another than the coach, Butch McAdams. Now we're going to get the real deal. Real deal, Mr. Coach. Good morning, man.
Good morning, everyone. It was a great Super Bowl.
Good morning.
It was one of the better competitive played Super Bowls in a long time. You had two evenly matched teams with the exception of one position. And that's Patrick Mahomes. And you remember what I said last week about Mahomes. And hopefully people who know football understood and saw exactly what I was trying to say last week when I say that this guy is Johnny Unitas with mobility. And that's who he reminds me of. Because I saw Johnny U at a young age. You saw him as well.
Yes, I did.
And this guy was just so accurate with his passes. He was General Patton on the field, and he was a leader, and he was tremendous in the clutch. And you talk about overtime. Well, the first overtime game in the NFL championship was the Colts and the Giants, and Johnny Unitas led the way along with Lenny Moore and Al Alamici and
Gino McCray.
Huh?
Gino Marchetti.
Gino Marchetti, yeah. Okay. But Mahomes is special, man.
Yes.
I mean, this guy is special. And when you play the Kansas City Chiefs, especially in postseason, you cannot let them hang around. And I watched the game with my nephew, and I told him early on, I said, you know what? The 49ers are playing well, but they have to pull away. Because if it comes down the stretch and it's a one-score game, Mahomes will find a way to make it work. And we saw that. This guy, in my opinion, is in the top four quarterbacks of all time.
Now, you put him in the top what?
Top four of all time.
Whoa.
Now, you can rank them any way you want, but I would debate anyone, anywhere, anytime that would defy that these guys aren't in the top four. Now, and my top four would be Johnny Unitas, Joe Montana, Tom Brady, and Patrick Mahomes.
I don't disagree with that.
No one can.
Mark, Big E, y'all disagree with that? Those four right there, yeah. Okay.
Yeah, and again, in order to be great, I'm talking about really, really great, with the exception of a few, you got to have a ring. You got to have a ring. You know, like the old musician said, it don't mean a thing if you ain't got that ring. But you look at Kansas City. And you win a Super Bowl, for the most part, there have been exceptions, not many. You win with your head coach leading the way and your quarterback leading the way. Now, Brock Purdy played a lot better than I anticipated, but I just couldn't see him winning the game for the 49ers. But he played well. But, you know, Patrick Mahomes is just special, and he's not done yet. He's not done yet.
He's only 28 years old.
That's what I'm saying. And a quarterback, an average quarterback can play at a top level if he doesn't suffer serious injury up until he's 36, 37 years old. So another 10 years, another 10 years of brilliance for Mahomes. Now, we don't know how long Andy Reid will stay around. He could retire today or tomorrow, which would be wise, but I don't know if that
would. Why would you say it would be wise?
Well, because, again, I always believe a good entertainer knows when it's time to get off the stage. And when you're coaching, you know, you don't want to go out a loser. You don't want to be forced out like Belichick was. You want to go out on your own terms, and you want to go out on a winning note. And I don't care who you are. If you stay around coaching a long, long time, you're going to have some losing seasons.
Well, yeah, I do feel sorry for the guy up in Boston. Yeah, he's is he going to still look for another position, you think, within the league?
Well, he was looking for a position this year, but all the positions have been filled up. Now, I don't know what moving forward, what he's going to do, but, and you know, again, you can't tell an individual how to run his or her life, but if I were him, I'd call it quits because there's nothing else to accomplish. There's nothing else to accomplish. You were talking earlier about Lamar Jackson winning the MVP and during the regular season, he certainly was the MVP, no question about it. But now Lamar and Harbaugh, remember I talked about the tandem so important in postseason as head coach and quarterback. Now they got to figure it out. They have to figure it out, and they have to understand that the postseason is different from the regular season. It's totally different. And they've got to figure that out. They've got to figure that out in their preparation, and they've got to figure that out in their performance during the game.
I'm sure there might be some plays or something either Mark or Ian can say, but, Coach, yeah. I was taken back by this one incident where the tight end took on the coach. And I was just wondering, I don't remember ever seeing something like that. Did you see that scene?
Oh, yeah, I saw it. It happens all the time, okay? It happens all the time, especially at the professional level where you may have – and I bet you that coach didn't have a problem with it because the guy wanted to win. And I believe he went to him and said, come on, coach, get me the ball. Get the ball in my hands. I can win it for you.
Mm-hmm.
And so, no, that happens a lot, and I think it's healthy.
Okay. I don't remember ever seeing a scene like that.
Oh, no.
Big E was telling me coming in there that he wanted, he wanted a play, and the play went foul, and I guess he felt he could do a better job had he been in there to make that play.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Absolutely.
Competitive. Yeah. If you're a competitor, you just want to play, you know. You know, he fumbled the ball, and you feel like you know, that was your position. You could have been out there. Yeah, you got that fire, and they wouldn't mad at about it. You know what I mean?
Now, as a player, as I said, a player coach, most coaches have no problems with that. But now, as a coach, you can't let it linger. Okay, you go over, you speak your piece to the coach, and a smart coach will get the message, and he'll get the ball to you. Okay, but you just can't let it linger for 3, 4, 5, 6 minutes. No, you can't do that. Then it becomes more of a negative than a positive. But again, hey, that's Kelsey. Kelsey's a winner.
Yeah, he's a winner, all right. Taylor Swift.
Yeah.
Well, he's a winner on and off the field.
I'm just embarrassing you right there, Larry.
I hear you. What about I did not know that Kansas City's in fact, both of the kickers were pretty good coaches. One guy hit, what, a 57-yarder?
Yeah. No, both kickers played well, except that extra point that he hit it low. And that was a huge difference in the game. That was huge. Okay, but for the most part, both kickers played well. But again, you go back to kicking. As great as Mahomes is at the quarterback position, in my opinion, Justin Tucker is that player at the kicking position. He's the greatest kicker I've ever witnessed.
And with that note, Coach, Black History Month, two things. How special, because I know you remember when they were saying, you know, black quarterbacks not smart enough to play that position, and Doug Williams won. But you had four black coaches, all of them went to the playoffs. It was seven black quarterbacks in the playoffs. Black quarterback ultimately won. Black quarterback won the MVP, and they won the AFC championship. And I'm with you. I think the Ravens did not play their game. They brought Dalvin Cook in. I don't know why they didn't run the ball. And they disrespected our kicker before the game, and you didn't hear nothing about that. But how special Black History Month, how special, that's history, isn't it?
Oh, it's certainly history, and I remember when there were no black players playing, not just a quarterback, but guys, it was in the middle of the field, because the middle of the field depicts leadership. So you didn't see a black quarterback, obviously, but you also didn't see a black center or black middle linebacker, okay? And I love... You know, Larry, how you and I would get into these great debates a while back, and I said, man, I don't like the protests. I like action, okay?
Yeah.
And so the great Eddie Robinson, who was the greatest coach ever, in my opinion,
at
Grambling, he didn't complain. He didn't call the NFL system racist and talk about bigotry. I'm sure he could have. But you know what he did?
Put black players in the game.
No.
Teams. I'm sorry. No, go ahead.
But this is what he did. He went to the NFL coaches and the scouts, and he said, "You tell me, what do I have to do to get my guys ready to play in your league?"
Wow.
So, you know, in essence, what he did was, you just tell me, if you say that it's not about the color of their skin or their character, but it's about them lacking something, tell me what they lack, and I'll fix it. And so the end result was James Shaq Harris from Grambling was the first black quarterback to start at the beginning of the season.
Mm-hmm.
And now, just about, you know, it's almost mandatory for the most part to have a black quarterback, because a lot of the colleges have black quarterbacks. Okay, so that goes to your point, Mark. That goes to your point. But no, man, it wasn't. It was a long time before we saw a black face played a position of quarterback. And then in the 80s, of course, Doug Williams became the first black quarterback to start and win a Super Bowl.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Whew. Wow. Yeah. Well, listen, what I was implying but didn't do a thorough job, when I was responding to what he did, I remember that conversation you just gave us. And I thought what he did was he found a way to get his black players into the NFL. But you went on to explain how he did it. He went to the coaches and whatnot and got them to tell them, give me what you want, and I'll give you the ball players to match what you want. Just play them.
But see, back then it was different. And again, another great back and forth conversation you and I used to have. I would say it, you'd get upset, but, you know, we'd go back and forth. Where I would say, you know, L.Y., integration hurt the black community as much as it helped. And you say, what do you mean by that? I'm saying, look, you know, integration and the Civil Rights Bill should have been equal access to, not assimilation. And what I mean by that is, hey, the black colleges in sports suffered greatly by integration, because Grambling, with all those great players, Florida A&M, Jackson State, South Carolina State, Morgan. Look at Morgan. Look at all those great players Morgan had.
And Coach Banks.
Guess what? They ain't going to black schools anymore for the most part. When you turn the TV on and you see a Georgia or Clemson or an Alabama, 40, 50 years ago, those schools were not recruiting black athletes. And those black athletes that weren't recruited in Southern schools were going to black institutions. And the first black player, this is black history, the first black player, football player, to go to a Southern school was a guy named Darryl Hill. Have you ever heard that name? Darryl Hill, Washington, D.C., went to University of Maryland. And he was the first black, and not only at Maryland, to play football, not only in the ACC, but at a Southern institution.
Wow. Well, listen, good to you. I've got our Annapolis report getting ready to come up. I'm definitely reach out to you. I've got something that you hopefully will be able to respond in the affirmative. But thank you very much for coming on board, good fella. And I will catch up with you hopefully before the week, middle of the week. Thank you very much. Appreciate you. Family, the best in the sports. Coach Butch McAdams, thank you so much, good man. Let's take a 30-second and we'll be right back. And we'll be hearing from the state senator himself. That's right. I'm going to call him Mr. Annapolis. State Senator Cory McCray. Hold tight.
That's right.
Never thought I'd feel this way. And as far as I'm concerned, I'm glad I got the chance to say that I do believe I love you. And if I should ever go away, well then close your eyes and try. Feel the way we do today. Can remember, keep smiling, keep shining, knowing you can always count on me. For sure, that's what friends are for good times.
Good morning. Here we go. Back with you. We got a lineup, every line lit, so we want to get everybody in. But before we do that, we've got to get our legislative update, and we got the man to do it, a friend, State Senator Cory McCray of the 45th District. Good morning to you, good sir.
L.Y., always good to hear your voice.
Talk to us. How are we doing this session?
L.Y., you know what? This week was a really good week. One of the things that I came in with was starting with commercial titling. L.Y., I'm not sure if you know this, but, like, we keep track of MBE for everything, but there are some things that are left out. And one of the industries that's left out is commercial titling. It was brought to my attention by some really, really good sisters that celebrating 25 years in business, Integrity Title, Sheena and Monzella. And what we did was we had the bill to make sure that we can bust some transparency around this industry and making sure that we are reporting, but also making sure that the goals apply and making sure to understand if we're not meeting those goals, having goals for the governor's office of small and minority businesses report out what steps we're going to take for that. The next one that we had was owner-occupied homes being removed off the tax sale list. So currently, the mayor is able to do that if he gets a resolution and things of that nature. We want to cut all of those extra steps necessary. And that way, when we're talking about protecting generational wealth, that those folks are still have the ability to have what was left in their respective family
from that standpoint. We're digging through the budget. We're starting to have some of the budget hearings, LY. We had the, I chair the subcommittee Health and Human Services. So we've had the health department several times. We've had some of the smaller agencies come through, but we're starting to come through at this moment from that standpoint.
Whoa, okay.
Wow.
Do you have any idea as to, what you think of the state of the state?
I thought the state of the state was right on time, LY. Like, just being able to stand in this monumental moment where we have a governor that was super, that is super intentional. I think that his focus on housing and the dollars that's added from the Baltimore region, but across the state, is going to be instrumental to make sure that we're successful. I think that I really enjoyed that he talked about the long-term goals, LY. Like, I'm a big proponent of planning and proper planning. I think that you have short-term goals that you're trying to achieve year to year, but we cannot look at things from a year to year. We have to look at it from a 10 or 15 year. So I was very ecstatic and very excited about the long-term planning of our government so that we know what direction that we're steering the ship, and that it's a clear direction. We understand our leader and making sure that he repeats this all the time, that you need all of us to ensure that we're going in the right direction.
Okay. Now, I was understanding that there's going to be 5 education bills to watch this session. You have any idea about that package?
The education component, I don't know as much. I do know that the blueprint was fully funded within the budget. I do know that there are a number of bills that have come to try to tweak the blueprint, and that is a good thing from that standpoint. I think that we're looking at from the county and city appropriations. We're looking at how the dollars are being held accountable from that standpoint. But that is what, to the extent that I'm knowledgeable about the education component. But all of it will have to come to the Senate floor if it's going to pass.
Fantastic. Well, do you anticipate still the Baltimore City package is moving through pretty good?
I feel as though Baltimore is in a very good posture, LY. When I talk to our higher education institutions, Morgan and Coppin are doing phenomenal. Our community college, Dr. McCurdy, I talked to her. She said that they did phenomenal in the budget. Housing, we're getting an extra 20 plus million dollars in Bernie, but also getting extra money in core dollars. So that'll be extra money towards the city. As stated, the blueprint is fully funded, and the only thing that we have to keep our eye on at this moment is transportation.
I concur with that. Listen, you're the first Democratic person I've had a chance to ask this question. If you want to take a pass and come back with an answer next week, but if not, knowing you, you're going to go straight at it. What do you think about this Senate campaign of Larry Hogan coming in to the campaign?
You know what? Yep, so I'm Team Also Brooks all day long, LY. We just did an event, 100 Men for Also Brooks, over Saturday. I think that Hogan is well-liked. I think that it will not be easy. But I'm super excited about also Brooks. Hogan, in my opinion, we did a lot of great things together. But, like, I'm thinking about the moment that we stand in from a representative from women sitting at the table, specifically black women being able to sit at the table and being able to make sure that we lead from the state of Maryland, and having that diversity within our respective delegation is very, very important. And I think that Angela also Brooks hit all those points.
All right. Okay. Well, sir, I'll catch up with you. I'm going to be trying to put together a program. I've been watching the NSBC program on Black Men in America. And they put together 4 or 5 strong folk, and they had that discussion. And I want to do one on Black men in Baltimore, Black men in Maryland. And I'm going to look at your schedule, because when I put that group together for my podcast special hour and a half discussion, I'd like to have you be considered, if we can find some time for you to be there or be a part of that through Zoom or however means we can do it. I just feel if we're going to talk about black men in Maryland, about black men in Baltimore City, we would not do it right unless we had you involved. So I'll find you. Okay, good man?
L.Y., I just thank you for always just amplifying those voices, and I will always make time for you, the WLB family. I just came from Johnson Square Elementary. I like to stay in our schools, but I said I got to get on the L.Y. show, and I'm glad.
Oh, wow. Thank you. Thank
appreciate you. State Senator Cory McCray of the 45th Legislative District with us every Monday with our legislative update. Thank you, Senator. Thank you so very much.
Hey, Larry.
Yes, sir. Quickly.
Real quick, I know we got a lot of calls. The best kept secret in Baltimore is the Center for Urban Families right across from you guys. I did an interview yesterday. Center for Urban Families is a workforce development and human service organization serving the communities of Baltimore City since 1999. I just want to get an address, 2201 North Monroe Street. And the phone number is 410-367-5691, 410-367-5691. Larry, they're doing so many amazing things. They're working with young ladies and young men and older people and returning citizens and on and on and on. And when you get a chance, Larry, I almost lost my life if I would have said the wrong thing right out in front of my house Saturday night.
Whoa. Okay. I will definitely I'm aware of the program, and right across the street from New Shallow Baptist Church, and they do some good works.
Yeah.
And in fact, Barack Obama went over there when he was president.
Did he?
Yeah.
Wow. Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Okay, well, we got a long lineup, and the time is running, so let me quickly get to I'm going to believe I'm right about this, that Bill Gooden and Tyrone are going to be on the same. Well, I talked to Ray Davis. Sean, check and see if we could put Bill Gooden and Tyrone on at the same time. But in the meantime, let me hear from Ray Davis. Brother.
No bad days.
Yeah, I know. I got the right one.
That's him.
That's his trademark. Good morning, sir.
Good morning and happy new year to everyone. And
thank you, my brother.
I was thinking, I heard a little bit of the coach going over some of the great quarterbacks, and I don't know if he talked about it, but one day I know he would want to. One of the many reasons I don't watch football, one of the many reasons is up until even now, they always question the intelligence of a black quarterback to quarterback a team. And as Mark pointed out, how many, you know, great NFL quarterbacks who are black they are. And I thought that was a good point, Mark. But
thank you.
The game, to me, is still overtly racist. If a player protests, they burn their jersey. I have a major problem with CTE. CTE is the brain damage the sport causes. And what many fans don't realize, a lot of professional football players, some of the best ones, will not allow their children to play football because they've seen the damage of the brain damage that CTE, the collisions, cause. So, but I just wanted to say you know, to Mark and to you, I appreciate the work you all do. And Larry, I hope to see you Saturday.
Looking forward to it.
I have Dr. David Miller, Dr. Lamar Shields, Dr. Andrew Bunley, Dr. Tyrone Powers, Richard Rowe, the great Earl Ellamine, and many other heavyweights. So we are going to be very strategic in our planning and our discussion, and anything that we can do to help your cause, let us know. And I told Dr. Bunley and Tyrone the same thing. We're there to help fuel each other's fire.
Amen.
So I look forward to seeing you all. And Mark, continue, you know, the great work that you're doing. And I just wanted to give you all a quick shout out. I don't want to monopolize the time, but no bad days. And there's plenty of work to done. I would say to the audience that if you can only just stop by an elementary school if you're retired and ask how you can help talk to the children, we all need to be doing something because that's the only way we're going to make a change, and that's how we pay tribute to our ancestors that sacrificed to put us in the position we're in today. Thank you. God bless
us. We thank you. We're certainly going to get you on board soon, real soon. Thank you very much now.
Right,
okay. Am I right, Sean, that we got the two of them together? Is that how it's going to go? Let's go.
Okay, this is Calvin Bose. Good morning.
Good morning, you gentlemen. Gentlemen, how are you both?
I'm good. Thank you, Larry.
All right. Either one can start and tell us what's going on Friday and how we could all participate.
Well, I want to first thank you, Larry, for your leadership and the leadership of man on this issue. And it's very important that we show out this way. I want to go over some things that they're saying in the court, as they have in the court, that the media isn't telling you about, okay? Because the biggest thing about this is that the right-wing media and regular media, Fox 45 and all that stuff, when they put out stuff about this trial, once I come home from court, I listen to that stuff, and it's like I'm in a different world.
And Tyra, just one second. We're talking to family about the case of Marilyn Mosby. Go ahead and tell them.
Yes, thank you, sir. Thank you, sir. Okay, so, yes, it's Marilyn Mosby. So one of the things that they're not putting out in the media is that the binder that contains Marilyn Mosby's mortgage application is about 12 inches wide. Nobody's going to read all that stuff at closing. And I actually sold real estate years ago for my brother when he was putting together houses. And as a real estate professional, I would just tell him, look, this is about lead abatement, sign here. This is about asbestos, sign here. And he was assigned it because he trusted that I already looked over that stuff. And that's my job as a professional to make sure it's correct. And even if I didn't catch it, the mortgage company, it's up to the mortgage company and the title company and the credit company to catch that anyway. That's why you pay mortgage insurance. So this stuff is none more than the weaponization of routine mortgage law to try to entrap her in something because of the fact that she prosecuted cops, dirty cops. And let me say that dirty cops do not make your neighborhood safe. What they do is they foster mistrust among the citizens and make it hard to solve crime because nobody trusts them. They're not going to trust you if you're in a drug gang. And police have been caught in Baltimore. Not all police are bad. Let me say that first. Not all police are bad, but they have found cops in Baltimore guilty of selling drugs, paying drugs on people, robbery, burglary. We don't want those cops in our neighborhood. We don't want people selling drugs, but we don't want you to break their neck. Take them into court. Let him have a day in court. Okay. The other thing they were saying what she was found guilty of was giving her husband $5,000. He didn't have the money, but she wired him $5,000 and he sent it back to her in a gift, right? Okay, fine. But she did not type up the document. That's what people gotta understand for that issue. She did not type those documents up. Her mortgage company typed it up. A computer checked the box. Okay? Now, and then I can tell you this on right-wing media or Fox 45. A computer checked the box, and her mortgage company, a guy flew up from Florida, to testify in court that was his mistake, that was his fault. He told her to sign it. Don't worry about it. He said it's purely procedural. You know, nobody is going to be worried about this stuff. We need to do this to get the house. And I'm telling you, as a former real estate agent, I'm telling you, dude, people are so happy to get the house, they're going to check every box you tell them to check. Because they know if they don't check it, they're not going to get the loan. And they're so happy to get the house, they're going to check it. And they already know the title company's going to check this as well anyway. So I just want to put that out there. And another thing, they didn't let them use the word knowingly on the verdict sheet. In other words, the judge briefed that in order to have been found guilty of committing a crime, you got to have criminal intent. You got to show criminal intent that you, even if you hurt somebody, you cannot
be guilty
of a criminal intent. Okay, let me just go real quick. And then, but they're not saying that in the news. They left a building off the verdict form. So, okay, they're not saying in the news. The other thing is they're not letting you know that the mortgage lien, once you found out about it, that lien was in a house that wasn't in her name. It was in her husband's name. It's a house that he bought before they were married. And once she found out about it, she paid it with her own money, her husband's mortgage lien. But they didn't want the jury to know that. They also, this is a big thing. Somebody in the jury overheard one of the security agents, who was a relative of one of the Ferry Gate officers, say something disparaging about Marilyn Mosby's guilt. And they would not allow those jurors to be pulled to find out who it was. Okay, so this trial, she's being railroaded. If they can do it to her, they can do it to anybody.
Let's talk about Friday because we time is running out.
I let Bill didn't have that.
Okay.
Hey, Larry. Mark, first and foremost, most thank you. You know, Friday, February 16th, good morning, 2024, there's going to be buses, a bus as well as vehicles leaving from New Shiloh Church, 2100 North Monroe Avenue. They're leaving at 9:15. So, you know, my position this whole thing, Larry, is to try to help us get as many people as possible to show up in court because, you know, when we talk about people power, then I don't never want people to think that the judges as well as jurors is not influenced by the citizens that turn out. So I'm asking people to please turn out. We need to turn out at least 1,000 people, Larry. We need to show this lady we appreciate her, you know, that we love her, and that, you know, it's not like she in trial, Larry, because she stole something from the citizens. She has some improprieties in her office. Everything she's in court for is either personal or about her money. And so I guess, you know, I'm going to add this to you, Larry, because you are a former legislator. You know, I know sometimes, you know, politicians kind of back away from each other when somebody gets jammed up in trouble. But as legislators, I mean, I would think that some of them would be concerned that, hey, hold up, okay. See, just say everything that they say she did, she did. But why would she be facing criminal charges and the possibility of going to jail, losing her law license, without just having a fine to settle this? Why would legislators be concerned about that, Larry?
Those who are probably being advised not to speak up. That's not the case all the time. I'm not a lawyer, but certainly if I was sitting in there knowing how I feel about Marilyn, I would have been able to say something. But
can I say something about
yes, and guys, I only have 4 minutes left, so I got to.
So again, I guess that's my question. I just want to throw that out there because we want to get politicians, you know, we want to get attorneys, we want to get citizens. We want everybody to turn out. I'm simply saying this in closing, Larry, because thank you so much for this opportunity. You know,
I'll do it again on Wednesday, too.
Excuse me?
I said I'll do it again on the podcast Wednesday, too, partner.
Okay. I don't want black people for us to say, man, we need to get somebody that in office that's not scared to go against the system. You know, because too many times our political leaders, you know, they're scared to go, they can't stand up for us. When Marilyn Mosby stood up for us,
yes, she did,
against the police, then, man, it was like a glory day, just like when Obama got elected. Black people around here was hollering, talking about how brave this woman is, how much courage she got, how much we love her. And now she get jammed up for some crazy stuff, and we do not show up to show her that we truly support her courage, that she stood up for us.
And she lost everything behind it. She stopped the 70
all right,
riot by bringing charges. Thank you, Larry, for having us on.
Anytime. And repeat it on Wednesday, if you would be so kind. Repeat it on Wednesday.
Thank you
so very much. Thank you now.
Thank you, Larry.
Let's quickly go to Leo quickly. Leo?
Yes.
Yes, very quick.
And everybody, I didn't want to say. Good morning. It's important to remember the names of individuals in this Marilyn Mosby case. Yes, I'll be on the bus Friday morning in her support. She's been the queen of fighting for justice for our people, and she should not and must not be forsaken. Larry Hogan hates her guts. Sergeant Frank Mancuso, the Fraternal Order of Police, Lodge Number 3, Baltimore City, hates her guts. And we have 3 U.S. attorneys for the District of Maryland, Robert Herr, Republican, Jonathan Lenzner, Republican, and Eric Barron, who's an African-American.
Right. Leo, I'm being told my clock is gone. I'm sorry. Yes, come back on me Wednesday. Thank you very much. Charles, right. I got 30 seconds. Come on, Charles, quickly.
Yes, Larry, I want to give kudos to 2 black men that we don't even know about, don't even talk about. Hello?
Go ahead, quickly.
That's Lloyd Austin and General Brown. These are two black men who is in charge of defending this country. The Secretary of Defense of black man, Lloyd Austin, and the Joint Chiefs of Staff, General Brown, of all armed forces. We need to talk about these two men more. Thank you.
All right. Black History Month, and we got to keep in prayer our our Secretary of Defense. He's back, I understand, in the hospital due to some complications that have come up. So we certainly have to keep him in prayer. Don't forget, next Tuesday, the New Shallow Baptist Church, Maryland Chapter of the National Action Network Black History Month event. We're going to be giving the Al Sharpton Lifetime Achievement Award to Kwaisi and Fume. And that's going to be next Tuesday at the New Shallow Baptist Church. We're going to be there. It's going to be a wonderful program, family, a little life fair, and we're going to honor 24 of our outstanding citizens with an honor roll award. And, of course, we're looking forward to the opportunity to meet you there. That's next Tuesday. And be listening into the podcast on YouTube, to the YouTube podcast, 10 to 11:30, channel Larry Young Media. Okay, Eric, Mark, and Sean, good team.